Warm welcome to our lecture series on organizational behavior. We are in our seventh chapter, which is on motivation, and this is going to be the final lecture in this particular chapter. A quick summary of what happened in the previous lectures. We defined what is motivation. We also looked at the motivational process, in which we explained what are needs. We also explained the different types of motives. Motives primarily are divided into primary motives, general motives, and secondary motives. Primary motives are unlearned motives or biological motives. General and secondary motives are learned motives. We also looked at psychological motives in detail. We also looked at how conflict can be a powerful motivating factor. We discussed about the problems of using money as the sole motivator in workplace. We also started looking at different theories of motivation, which are broadly classified into content theories and process theories. So content theories talk about what motivates people, and process theory talks about how motivation process happens. We looked at a very famous theory called Maslow's theory of need hierarchy, in which we spoke about different levels of needs and how people move from one level to another level. We also looked at some of the criticisms in this approach of understanding motivation, and also how this theory can be used in organizational context. We also looked at different factors which motivate people in workplace and classified them into two major categories: motivators and hygiene factors. So hygiene factors, absence of hygiene factors will lead to dissatisfaction of employees, dissatisfaction among employees. Presence of hygiene factors will lead to neither satisfaction nor dissatisfaction. So it will be absence of dissatisfaction. Doesn't mean that people will be satisfied when hygiene factors are there. So in order for the employees to be satisfied, we need certain factors called as motivating factors, motivators. So only when motivators are there, employees will be satisfied. So only satisfied employees will perform well. Hygiene factors will help employees to retain, or will help organizations to retain employees. I also showed you the list which had questions related to hygiene factors and motivators. So the scoring key for that test or the questionnaire is given here. Please try it and check which one of them motivates you more. We also looked at ERG theory, and we also discussed about the relevance of ERG theory in organizational context, and also how it is similar to other two theories which we saw earlier. So this is where we stopped. So till this point, the theories which spoke about motivation are content theories. So this particular theory, from this particular theory, we are going to talk about process theories, which means what and how motivation happens. So the how part of motivation. I also discussed about this three terms in the previous lecture. So I'll quickly give you an example. If a person has to be motivated in workplace, first and the foremost important thing is the reward should be attractive. In other words, the employee should feel the reward is worth pursuing or worth achieving, which is balance. So balance means the employees feel the particular reward is worth achieving, or the employee values that particular reward. So that is balance. So once a person feels it is valid, or the reward is valuable enough to pursue, the second important process is expectancy. Expectancy means I should feel as an employee I value the goal, and the second thing is I should feel I'll be able to achieve that goal. In other words, I should feel I have the capacity to perform to that level where I can achieve the goal. So that is expectancy. Third important process related variable is instrumentality, which is I should understand or I should feel my performance will lead to goal achievement. In other words, I value the goal, I understand or I know that I have the potential and capacity to perform to that level, and if I perform, there are more chances that I will get that reward, or my performance will lead to that reward. So that perception or that sense is called as instrumentality. My performance will be instrumental in achieving the goal. So when will someone have less instrumentality? So I value the goal, I have the capacity to perform, but even if I perform, I may or may not get the goal. So when will I know for sure I will get the goal? Only when I feel the processes are fair, or there is fairness in evaluation processes for allocating those rewards. Okay. I gave you an example in the previous lecture about these three concepts. Now we'll look at each one of them and understand their relevance in human resource management, more specifically performance management systems, and also how to use these three concepts in motivating employees to perform better using a good reward system. Okay. The first concept, balance. So how will we nurture balance among employees? Or the first and foremost thing is the goal should be attractive enough to most people, or the reward should be attractive enough to most people. So we should reward, as HR managers, we should design the rewards in a way that many people should feel it attractive, or at least based on the target audience, we should design the rewards so that the target audience will be attracted or motivated to perform. In other words, that particular reward should drive employees to get attracted towards those rewards. So how will you design a goal which is very attractive, or how will you design a reward which is very attractive? If you remember in the previous class, previous lecture, I was talking about the young employee award, the best young employee award. So let's say the organization has something called best young employee award, and it's just a certificate. Okay. And many people get it. So will it be attractive to people? No, they know that everybody in some point at some point in their tenure, if they are joined freshly, they will get. Okay, it's not very attractive. On the other hand, instead of young, along with young employee award, you can also have a clause or have a criteria, have a extra reward which says if you would have got this best young employee award, you will be given one extra promotion or one extra increment. Okay. So it will obviously attract people, because especially young employees, for them promotion, having one extra promotion or one extra increment will add to their reward, will add to their economic safety and security. So if you remember, we looked at in Maslow's hierarchy of needs, when employees are at the lower level of their hierarchy, they prefer safety and security, and also monetary benefits. So many times employees at the lower level, or employees who are newly joined the organization, young employees, they would prefer to have more monetary rewards and also safety needs. Okay. So based on which level employees are in, we can design the rewards. For example, you are designing a reward system for middle level managers. So middle level managers, they would have spent 10 to 15 years in their career. Maybe they would have spent long years in the same organization. So for them, pay would may not necessarily be a great motivating factor, because anyway, they would have reached a state where, they have enough money in terms of safety and basic needs. So instead of saying, you know, we'll pay you money for middle level managers, we can tell them, you'll get a certificate and which will be given to you by our CEO. Okay, so recognition, so getting a certificate from the CEO is a great motivating factor for these kind of managers, middle level managers. What about top level managers? What will motivate top level managers? If you like people who are like, you know, 50 years old or 55 years old, who are in the president and vice president level of the organization, you cannot just pay them money, because anyway there will be like enough money with them. Recognition also doesn't matter, because anyway they are at the top. Okay, so what will motivate them? Sense of self-esteem or self-actualization. So you can reward them by saying, okay, if because you know you have performed well, your contribution to the organization is very important, we will recognize your performance or your contribution through creating some scholarship, or you know, creating or naming a unit or a reward on your name. Okay, so let's say you are there for a professor is there in the education institution for 30 years, he or she is going to retire. Nothing will motivate that person. Instead, you say, on your name, we are creating a chair position, or on your name, we are creating an award for best research scholar, something like that. So the person may not get anything in terms of monetary benefits or material benefits, but your name will be there forever in terms of a position or award named on behalf of you. Okay, so this is like this. There are many awards, national awards named after a leader. Okay, so at a very top level, these kind of things will motivate people. So first, for increasing valence, you should understand what reward or what kind of reward will motivate what kind of employees. Okay, the second important factor, which is expectancy. Expectancy is employees perceive whether they'll be able to achieve, they have the capacity to achieve that goal, or whether the goal is realistic enough to achieve, whether it is reachable. Okay, so how will you make a reward reachable, or how will you make the reward be felt by the employees as something which is reachable? So most if you want to motivate many employees, all of them should feel, okay, I can reach this if I try. You know, that feeling should come. Only few people trying for that is not enough, because others will not try and only best performers will perform. Okay, so if you remember in the learning theory, the role of reward is to motivate people. Okay, so if you remember partial reinforcement, reinforcing people at regular interval, you know, those kind of mechanisms. So the reward should be good enough. So there should be some level of conditioning which should happen among all the employees. So everybody should have hope. At least majority of the people should have hope that they will achieve, that they can achieve that goal. So expectancy is that. If there is low expectancy, many people feel I can't achieve this goal, there is no point in having that reward, because only very few people will try for that reward, and others will keep quiet and they will not even try. They will not even perform to that level. So any reward, it should be achievable for most people. Okay, at least that feeling should come. So how will you do that? What if you make the reward very, very challenging or very, very unachievable? Let's say only 2% of the people can achieve it. Okay, what will happen if that is the case? It will lead to demotivation of many people. Many people won't even try, the first case. What will happen if you make it achievable for most people? Everybody will think, this is like not challenging. Everybody will achieve. Even if I don't perform, I will achieve. Or the best performers, they will think everybody is going to get, why should I perform? I will perform to my moderate level. Okay, so it should be challenging enough to make people feel it is achievable. At the same time, not all of them should be able to achieve it. Okay, so it should be designed in a way that it gives a sense of, you know, reachable goal, but in reality it should be tough, okay? Because only when it is tough, people will have that motivation. So how will you do it? Again, it depends on understanding your group, understanding your employees. What are their potential? How many of them will be able to achieve it? How will you, communicate that goal to most employees so that they will feel motivated? So all those things are expectancy. You know, you should make people feel they are capable to achieve that goal. Okay. Instrumentality. Instrumentality is fairness. How will you increase instrumentality? You know, I have tried everything. I have put my fullest potential. I have given my fullest capabilities and performance, but I'm not getting something. Somebody else who has performed less than me has gotten this reward. What will happen if people feel that? It will have a negative effect. You know, people will underperform. They will think, whatever I do, even if I work like a donkey, I'm not going to get the reward, because there are some people who will get it even without performing. Okay, it will give a sense of unfairness, injustice. So injustice is a very, very dangerous thing for organizations, because it will not just lead to lack of motivation, it will lead to demotivation among employees. And also in long run, it will lead to, negative culture in the organization. Culture in the sense, people will start gossiping or saying bad things about management, people will quit, people also damage organizational property, you know, all those negative behaviors will exhibit. Okay, so how will you make a goal, or how will you increase instrumentality? A very important thing about instrumentality is having clear-cut procedures and communicating that procedures. So this is the award, these are the basic criteria for applying for that award, or to be considered or to be shortlisted for that award. So all that criteria should be clearly listed. And also, you should also mention what are the processes involved. How will we shortlist? Who will shortlist? You know, let's say if this is the reward, how will you measure, as an organization, how will I measure your performance? How much weightage will be given for each of those criteria? What are the things we are looking at in people? Who are the judges? And also at each level of shortlisting or performance evaluation, they should be clearly communicated to the employee. So transparency and clear-cut procedures and communicating those procedures to the employees will increase instrumentality. Otherwise, if everything is like a black box, suddenly one person gets the reward, nobody knows why this person got the reward, how did they evaluate, when did they evaluate, it's not going to help. Okay, so fairness will increase instrumentality. So keeping all these three factors in mind and how to improve them, we can design very good performance reward systems in organizations, which will not only motivate best performers, but also people who are in the mediocre level to aspire for those goals, so that they will also push themselves to perform to their fullest. So if you can, so you would have understood how Vroom's theory can be a wonderful theory which can be applied in human resource management to encourage employees to perform better through better reward systems. Okay. There's another interesting theory which talks specifically about rewards. Okay. So in the earlier theory, we spoke about what happens in reward systems. Here, we are going to talk about purely about rewards and how rewards motivate people, the process involved in motivation through reward systems. Okay, let's say there is a reward and you have gotten a reward in that organization. Reward in the sense, you know, there's a bonus. Suddenly, in the performance cycle, end of the performance evaluation cycle, you got a bonus. Okay, so will you feel happy? What will you do? You'll feel very happy, isn't it? Suddenly the next month pay bill or your pay slip, you see a particular amount, you know, extra some amount written as performance bonus. You'll feel happy? You'll feel very happy, isn't it? you'll feel happy momentarily. Next thing you will do is you will ask your friend, hey, did you get that bonus also? Because this friend is also in the same company, same level, same cadre, and also same potential. So this friend is also similar to you in terms of performance. You know that he worked with you, he or she is working with you, and he also performed similar to you. Okay, he's not like extraordinary or lower than you. Okay, so you get the bonus, you call your friend, ask that friend, did you get any bonus? The friend says yes. Okay, so you will not, you feel okay because he also worked like me and same level, probably he also got bonus. Next question you'll ask is, how much did you get? If the friend is close enough for you, you will ask him or her, how much did you get? Let's say the friend says twice the amount which you have got. Okay, how will you feel? You got extra money, but that itself is not sufficient. You know, we compare it with comparable others. Okay, so comparable others means someone who's at the same level in terms of performance and also in rank. Okay, so motivation in terms of reward will always be based on comparison. Okay, so when we get a reward or a, you know, extra benefit for our performance, we compare it at two levels. First level we'll compare it within ourselves in terms of, okay, this is the performance I showed and this is the reward I got. Input versus output. So this is the input I gave to the job and this is the output I got, which is the reward. So if I think my input is too high but the output is too less, I'll feel demotivated. Okay, if I feel my input is to a certain level, output equals that input, I deserve it, you know, I deserve that award. Okay, and also second level of comparison is you compare your input output with somebody else's input output. So the same level of my input, somebody else also have put that level of input, their output should also be same as my output. Okay, so I know that at a very personal level my input output ratio is, you know, okay, I performed this much, what I got is I deserved it. But let's say somebody else, same level of input, but their output is very high. What will happen? Higher than yours. You'll feel demotivated. You know, what is this? You know, I also worked this much, he also worked this much, but he has got more reward. Okay, so it will demotivate you. So this balance is called equity. Equity means equal. You know, there should be some level of fairness. So if there is somebody else getting more than you, who's comparable to you, you will feel it is unfair, it is unjust. Okay. So coming back to another scenario, another extreme scenario. So you got a bonus, you're asking your friend who's similar to you, you're asking him how much bonus he got, and he has got zero bonus. Okay, he also worked like you, he also has the same potential, but he got no bonus. Okay, how will you feel? You'll feel bad, you know, you'll be a little shocked. Why he didn't get? Okay, second thing you'll do is you'll try to justify. Probably, you know, boss didn't notice his performance, or probably he would have done something which boss got, you know, upset, something else which I don't know, boss got upset, or probably, you know, something which I do, boss prefers more. Okay, so you try to justify. But let's say you get more information about nothing like that has happened, but you got more bonus, but your friend similar performance didn't get bonus. How will you feel? You will feel it is also bad for the organization, because even though you got reward, you will feel there is no connection between my performance and reward. Maybe luck, you know, maybe not because of my performance I got this reward, because same performance my friend also showed. Maybe performance doesn't matter, something else matters. Maybe I should be good to my boss. Maybe I should, you know, be nice to my higher authorities. Performance doesn't matter, because same level of performance also, people are not getting rewards. Okay, So that will also lead to demotivation in long run. So if you want employees to perceive equity, this two ratios has to be maintained. One, individual employees input output, and also this comparison of comparable others in terms of input output ratio and the similarity in terms of how or disparity. You know, there should be less disparity between two people who are of similar performance. Okay, so I'll stop here because the next theory is also going to be a very elaborate theory, very interesting theory, which is called job characteristics theory, which talks about purely about the nature of the job and how to make a job interesting enough for people to perform. Okay, I'll stop here. We'll meet in the next class. Till then, take care. Goodbye.